Again, as Roberto said, this presentation aims to show some technology on how to develop web application that will be integrated in Science Gateway. And this presentation is split in two main parts. The first part where you will see some technological aspects that are involved in Science Gateway, and then we will see a more practical part where we see an example of application, web application that exploit FutureGateway APIs to deal with e-infrastructures. This is the outline. We will see briefly some introductory consideration about Science Gateway, and then I'll try to show you what Science Gateway is, and we will see the Science Gateway models and an implementation of Science Gateway adopted by Sci-GaIA, the Africa Grid Science Gateway. We will see the components of the Africa Grid Science Gateway, and then some detail about the installation of Science Gateway. We will see the hardware requirements adopted by Africa Grid Science Gateway in particular. And finally, the last part is focused on application development, and we will see a more general concept about web application development, and then we will focus our attention on Portlet, that is a special kind of web application developed in Java, and for Java technologies. This is the Open Science Gaia platform. You have seen this many times during these days. And as I told you, we focus our attention on the Science Gateway, one of the components of the Open Science platform. By definition, a Science Gateway is a community development set of tools, application, and data that is integrated via portal or a suite of application, usually integrated in a graphical user interface. This is the definition of Science Gateway, and it is in, on the right side of this slide, you will see the Africa Grid Science Gateway. And as you can see, it adopts the Catania Science Gateway frameworks to initially to adopt the Catania Science Gateway framework to develop application. And we will see more detail about the Catania Science Gateway framework during this presentation. Then, since the eResearch Hackfest we held in Catania, we moved from the Catania Science Gateway framework to Future Gateway you saw yesterday in Ricardo's presentation. In last month, we managed to move the Africa Grid Science Gateway from our server in Catania to an infrastructure in Dar es Salaam, at DIT, the Dar es Salaam Institute of Technologies. So, Science Gateway. This is a typical scenario in which Science Gateway came and tried to provide help to communities of practice. What we can see is that we have many organizations that have their own application, and on the other side we have the e-infrastructure made by grid systems or HPC system or or cloud-based infrastructure, but and the community of practice would like to exploit the huge amount of computing resources and storage resources provided by the infrastructure. But the problem is, how can this application exploit those resources? This is often hard to adopt e-infrastructure due to their distributed nature. In particular, for example, They adopt very difficult for non-experts people security mechanism to access this. And often among the different middleware are adopted, and the application need to know details on the infrastructure where they should run. To overcome this problem, the Science Gateway can help communities of practice to exploit infrastructure. And in particular, a Science Gateway can provide this DCI interface from one side that allows to exploit the benefits, allow to exploit the resources provided by infrastructure from a side, and from the other side, through an application interface, and through the application interface, the user, the researchers, can exploit these infrastructure seamlessly. So now, let me explain better how you can develop your own Science Gateway. And as you saw yesterday, FutureGateway is a framework to develop Science Gateway that provide a set of REST API. And here we have the legacy way to access infrastructure adopted, implemented by the Catania Science Gateway Framework. And in particular, in this case, you can access infrastructure to a module, to a Java library integrated inside the Science Gateway named Grid and Cloud Engine. So if your community doesn't have a portal, a way to exploit infrastructure through Science Gateway is to develop an application, to develop a web application that will be integrated in the Science Gateway based on Liferay technologies. And this application, this interface, this web interface is a portlet. We will see more detail on what is a portlet later in this presentation. The other approach is if the community has their own portal, you are planning to develop a new portal from scratch based on your knowledge or based on the technology you are comfortable with, you can develop your application using your languages and exploit the REST API provided by the Future Gateway to access the infrastructure. Then another layer implementing the federated authentication allows to access these Science Gateways. You saw in Marco's presentation what federated authentication is. Now, a brief recap on Future Gateway. Future Gateway is a framework to build Science Gateway. It is an evolution of another product named Catania Science Gateway Framework. And it tried to resolve some problems that Catania Science Gateway has in adoption, in wide adoption. It provides an installation and maintenance script to facilitate the creation of new Future Gateway instances on your communities. It provides a flexible and uniform access to distributed computing services, and it provides a RESTful API frontend. That is the major improvement respect of the Catania Science Gateway framework. This because you can call the REST API provided by the Future Gateway from any kind of platform using any kind of technology that can issue HTML calls. Another important feature of the Future Gateway is that it is backend portal independent because it provides REST API and it's not a Java library like the Grid and Cloud Engine that I showed you before. Here's another some of the major feature of both technologies. On the left side, we have the Future Gateway. And as I told you, it is backportal independence through the RESTful API frontend, while the Catania Science Gateway framework depends on technology of the backportal because it is a Java library. So the portal that can use Catania Science Gateway framework should be a portal based on Java. It provides an easy installation and maintenance system through a set of scripts that you can find at the link in this slide, while the Catania Science Gateway framework provides a set of steps that you have to perform to have your own in instance of a Science Gateway based on Catania Science Gateway framework. Another important difference among Catania Science Gateway framework and Future Gateway is that Future Gateway provides a quick application development. This thanks always of the REST API, because FutureGateway can be called from any application, from mobile application, from web application, and so on. While the application developed based on Catania Science Gateway framework needs to specific knowledge based on Java and Liferay. This slide recap the components that belong to a Science Gateway. And a Science Gateway consists of a set of application tools and data organized in a graphical user interface. It provides an interface that allows to exploit in a seamless way various kinds of distributed computing infrastructure resources. And it consists also of a set of linked services to the Science Gateway that allows it to work properly. For example, the identity provider and other services that we will see soon. The actor in the Africa Grid Science Gateway are the web frontend. That is the portal where your application should be placed. It is based on Liferay 6.1 technologies, portal container. And this portal container is deployed on an application server that is the Glassfish 3.1 application server. The DCI interface is provided by a Future Gateway instance connected to the Africa Grid Science Gateway and by the Catania Grid and Cloud Engine library for legacy applications. So for those applications was developed before the adoption of Future Gateway. Another service connected to the Catania Science Gateway connected to the Africa Grid Science Gateway is the eToken server. That is a service that provides the proxy certificate used to access some kind of infrastructure that adopts this kind of authorization mechanisms. The identity provider and the LDAP registry to manage the authorization of user. Regarding the web frontend, as I told you, it is based on Liferay technologies, in particular Liferay 6.1. Liferay is a Java-based framework to create a portal. And just a tip for production environment, should be avoid to use bundled version provided of Liferay because it's useful for development, but it missed some functionalities that could be useful in a production environment. In the Africa Grid Science Gateway, we adopt also MySQL as database management system. to implement the database needed by Liferay and the database used by the Catania Grid and Cloud Engine. As I told you, a dedicated instance of FutureGateway is connected to the Africa Grid Science Gateway to serve the application developed by the Sci-GaIA champions, and also an instance of the Catania Grid and Cloud Engine to support legacy application developed before the adoption of FutureGateway. The Catania Grid and Cloud Engine is a Java library based on an implementation of the OGF Saga specification. It is a specification that define a standard to access distributed computing infrastructure. An implementation adopted is JSaga. It is a Java implementation. And for more detail on what Catania Grid and Cloud Engine is, you can see the link that is a video lecture recorded during a winter school we held in Sci-GaIA project that specified the detail of the Catania Grid and Cloud Engine. This is the a schema of the Catania Grid and Cloud Engine. It consists of two interfaces. The first interface is is used by the application deployed on the Science Gateway. It is basically a set of API, Java API that can be called by the application. The other interface allows to exploit different kind of distributed computing infrastructure based on grid, local cluster, or cloud middleware. And it consists of also three main modules that are in the center of this slide. And they are the data engine, the job engine, and the user tracking and monitor module. The data engine is responsible to move data across different kind of distributed computing infrastructure, while the job engine manage the job. And the user tracking monitor module interact with a user tracking database that store each interaction made by the user to the distributed computing infrastructure. And another service connected to the Catania Grid and Cloud Engine is the eToken server that provides proxy certificates used to access DCI that use X509 based authentication. So the eToken server is a standard based service responsible for central management of robot certificates. It provides proxy certificates, and proxy certificates are mandatory to access some kind of infrastructure based on X509 authorization mechanism. Proxy certificates are generated starting from special certificate named robot certificate that are stored on a special USB key directly connected on the eToken server. And the eToken server also provide a web interface and a set of RESTful API to generate proxy certificate. If you would like to have more details on what eToken server is, you can follow the link in the slide. Regarding the creation of a science gateway, you can exploit our eToken server if you belong to a special VPN to access the eToken server, or otherwise you can install your own eToken server in your organization using a guide available on our documentation system. This is the web interface provided by the eToken server, and you have a set of accordion that you where you specify the proxy certificate you need, and finally you can generate a request to create a proxy certificate. The other way to create proxy certificate is using the REST API. And here we have an example of wget command that generate a user proxy certificate that can be used to access DCI. Identity provider is connected also to the Africa Grid Science Gateway to provide federated authentication. You saw today was what identity provider is. It provides identifier for user looking to interact with a service provider. And it provides other information about the user, sorry. But as you saw today, it provides just authentication mechanisms. If you would like to provide also authorization, so if you want that your user use application based on their own role, in this case, Africa Grid Science Gateway adopt an LDAP registries. And in the LDAP registry, roles and group are stored. And a user can access the page inside the Science Gateway based on the roles that they have. Here, some hardware specification on on the Africa Grid Science Gateway. And for the front end machine, from the web front end machine, we have 8 cores, 8 gigabytes of RAM, and 500 gigabytes of disk. This on the system is based on Ubuntu 14.04 operating system. The same Ubuntu release is used for the database machine, but in this case we use 2 core and 2 gigabytes of RAM and 20 gigabytes of disk. For the identity provider, these are the requirements that we are using on our machine. And these are the requirements used for the future gateway installation connected to the web front-end machine. Regarding the installation and configuration on our readed docs, you can find the step to install and configure a Science Gateway based on Catania Science Gateway framework. And while if you would like to install your own future gateway instance, there is an installation script that can be used to install your own instance of future gateway. This has been shown also by Ricardo in his presentation. Okay, now we can move on the last part of this presentation, in which we will see some detail about Science Gateway application development. So this is an example of a web page, in this case an example of the Wikipedia page. And as you can see, we have many elements that belong to this web page. On the left side, we have a menu. Then we have 4 boxes, 4 components in the center of the web page. And in the right corner here, you have a search box. So in the past, was your responsibility to create each of those elements that belong to this page. It was your responsibility to develop them. But now, using any kind of web application framework, you can. It provides some of these components, and you can just reuse it without any development. What you have to do is define how your web page should look like. And in particular, you have to define the layout of your page. So all the content of the page are shown to a user. For example, we can have a two-column layout, or that is this case, or an horizontal layout where each component are disposed placed horizontally in the page, or we can have a three-column and so on and so far. We can have many kinds of layout. Another aspect is the theme. While the layout is related to how the components are placed inside the page, the theme is related in how to this component should be shown to the user. So how they should look like. And as you can see we have some different example of how the same component placed in the same position are rendered in a different way based on the theme used in this page. So to create a web page, you have to define the layout, so all the components of this page should be rendered, and the theme of the page. I talked about component. This because each of most famous web development framework like Joomla, WordPress, or Drupal provide components in its framework. I was telling that different components developed for some portal technology could not be used in other one without any effort to try to customize, to try to develop it for the other. While from components, we moved to portlet in Java World, and in particular, this component, and in this case, the portlet, are based on two specifications, two Java specifications that are the JSR 168 and JSR 286 that standardize an interface to create module to create component in the Java world. And this means that you can reuse, you can deploy your application that are developed exploiting this specification with any changes, or at least with a few changes in a different kind of portal based on portlet on Java technologies. A portlet, you can consider a portlet like a small application. It has its own life cycle, and it is developed autonomously from the other component in the portal. And this is the life cycle of a portlet defined in the Java specification, in the JSR specification. And in particular, we have some events that are triggered by the portal itself, or by the user when a user perform some interaction with the portal. The init event is an event that belongs to the portlet lifecycle, is an event triggered by the portal. And in particular, this event is called when a portlet is deployed for the first time inside a portal. And this event is important to provide, for example, some configuration, some customization to the portal based on some parameter that you can configure and use it during the init event. Another event triggered by the portal is the destroy event. In this case, this event is called each time the server's process shut down correctly. Because if you kill the server's process for any reason, the destroy method has not been called. And this event is important, for example, can be used to provide to release some resources allocated by your application. For example, if you create locks on some resource, you can use this event to release this lock and leave the environment ready to be executed correctly the next time. The render events, the render phase, is an event triggered by the user, and in particular it is called when you open the page, you access the page where the portlet is deployed, is available. And it is responsible to create the HTML fragments that belong to this portlet, just for the box where the application, where the portlet is deployed. And you can create a render URL using this string, using this line of code. Another event is the server resource. The server resource is used to call, for example, to implement AJAX call, so to perform some action without regenerate the web page where the portlet is deployed. So, for example, to update some part of the HTML code inside your application. And you can create a server resource by creating a resource URL and specifying the name of the resource URL, and you can refer this URL to invoke a server resource from your application. This method was added in the JSR specification and the extension of the JSR specification. Then we have the process action. The process action is used to perform action on the server. So you can use the process action to submit form or to perform a specific process on the server, or for example to store data on a database. At the same way, to create there is a line of code, there is an instruction to create a process action URL. And as soon as your process action complete its execution, a new render phase is called. This is because this action can be changed the state of the server, and it can be useful to render again the page of your application, the interface of your application. And it is important to take in mind is that each portal deployed on the same page, every time you refresh this page, the render phase is called if you, for example, you have five portlets in the same page, five render URL render phase has been invoked. So it's better to not use render phase to make computation intensive process. This is explained in this. So we have many portlets deployed in this page, and each time you access this page, each time you refresh this page, a render phase is called for each portlet. While the process action is executed before any render, so you access the page and the render phase creates the HTML fragment to show the interface for your application. Then when the user click the submit button to submit, for example, a form to the server makes some process on this form, but no render phase is called in the meantime. When the process action complete its execution, a new render phase can be called based on the change of the state. Okay, you have many strategy to deploy, to develop portlet. In this case, this slide show a way to develop portlet. And in this case, your portlet in the slide named my portlet class should extend the generic portlet and have to implement, has to implement all method of the life cycle. So it's your responsibility to implement each method of the portlet life cycle. You have to provide also a portlet description inside some XML file. There are also other XML files that allow to provide some description for your application that are specific for the LifeRay framework, while these are based on GaIA standard. The LifeRay display description is also an XML file that provides the category where application belong, the organization that has deployed this application, and so on. Furthermore, we have a LifeRay plugin package property that are a file where where you can set the properties specific for the LifeRay plugin you are using to develop your portlet. All these components are packaged inside a war file that is actually a package that can be deployed on an application server. Another way to develop portlet is this time extend the MVC portlet. In this case, some of the methods that belong to the lifecycle of a portlet are implemented directly inside the portlet, and if you need particular implementation of this, you can override this method providing your own implementation. At the same way you saw in the last slide, the package that in the package there are the same description file and the properties for the plugin, LifeRay plugin used. There are many other technologies to develop a portlet. This slide just show the available technology, but in this presentation we will see the portlet based on the MVC portlet and on the AUI framework. We will see what AUI framework is later. So this is our choice to develop application that can be deployed on LifeRay portal. And we use LifeRay bundle with Apache Tomcat for development environment. We use the plugin SDK for 6.1 version. And we use also LifeRay Studio, that is an integrated development environment that based on Eclipse that provide you some suggestion on code, some documentation inline, and many other features. As I told you, the portlet you will deploy if you would like to adopt this technology are based on LifeRay portal, and it exploits the LifeRay UI tools, so a set of advanced user interface tools that you can reuse in your application, based on LifeRay taglib and on the Alloy UI JavaScript framework. Okay, this is the LifeRay taglib. that you should include inside your JSP page. And this taglib generates the HTML and CSS and JavaScript properly in order to include inside your page all the facilities provided by the framework. Using this, when your application will be deployed inside the portal, get all the look and feel of the portal, and you can reuse the same. Your application has no problem in visualization when you use these strategies. Alloy UI is a framework based on Yahoo user interface library. It provides several widgets used inside the Liferay portal and that you can reuse inside your application. It provides, for example, tabs, menu, form, etc. And it is a JavaScript library, so it can be used also in other kind of application, not only on Liferay-based web application. This is an example of Alloy UI. It can be used in two ways. One way is directly inside the script tags. The other way is using the AUI taglib. And this way is what you can see here. And in particular, we have, for example, the AUI input, that is an input test field that exploit the AUI feature. Here we have, for example, a select to that is a combo box where the user can choose among different values. Another taglib that provides more complex UI component is the Liferay UI taglib. It provides the search container, that is a component responsible to create table on your web page. It provides also paginator feature, search feature, and so on. We also have a captcha to avoid bot problems, etc. This is the Liferay search container looks like. And as you can see, it generates the HTML code to show your content inside a table. And it provides also, you can also provide specific action on what you want to do on each row that belongs to the search container. Liferay taglib provide also powerful mechanism to validate your form. And for example, if some input are required, you can use this validator to inform the user that has to insert some values inside this input field. Or you can provide a range in which the values should be, and so on, some validator for email, for example, or for date, etc. Liferay provides also a powerful mechanism to localize your application based on the user languages. And you can provide the localization inside a file properties, were named languages and the code of the languages, and a key value pair where we have the key and the value that should be used in the label. For example, here we have an input field that where the label use the title key. So if we are in Italian languages, for example, title will be replaced with titolo. Otherwise, you can provide the languages for other. Here we have just an example of a form used inside the Vue.jsp of the Weka portlet. That is the application showed by Roberto before. This is how the application looks like inside the web portal. And this is the code behind to create, to render this this HTML fragment. Here we are using an AWI form. The AWI, the form needs to have an action. In this case, this is an action URL. And it uses a post method. In particular, this form uses a multi-part form data encryption encrypt type. This is because it will upload a file to the server. Then we have just a field set that collects all the fields inside the form, and an input field of file type that render this in your portal, and allow the user to choose file from his system. And here we have used also a validator that accepts just some some extension for the file the user should upload. In this case, in this particular case, we are using just data, CSV, and RFF format that are extension that can be used in Weka. Then it creates a combo box with a set of value. In this case, just one, but in the next release of Weka application, we already added some other option for the select. And finally, we have a button to upload, the first time to upload this file to the server. This is the code behind in the server side. And as you can see here, we have the process action method that use the upload file, that is the name we give to the form. And this method is called as soon as the user click on the continue button. It gets the upload request from the action request. This because this is a particular kind of action. It's a particular kind of request because it uploads a file to the server. It gets this upload request and process and call a method named process input file, passing the upload request and the username of the user logged inside the portal and the timestamp. At the bottom of the slide, you can see the process input file method. And at this line, we get the file name from the upload request using the file input variable, file input name variable that is called the file input file upload. That let me show you back is the name of this input field. File upload is used here to get the file name, the name of the file uploaded by the user. As soon as the process action complete, it will render another JSP. Again, it render again the view JSP, but in this case, the HTML fragment generated are different from the one created before. And we can see we have a label that informs the user that a new file has been uploaded with the name, the username and a timestamp of the file. And then we have two radio buttons that are implemented by the code in here. In particular, we have a field wrapper to wrap both radio buttons. And the first is checked by default, while the second one is not checked. And here we have the name, and we can define where place the label for this radio button. Then at the end of the page, we have another select, just to select the classifier that should be used. As we see before, the submit button call the submit action method, And here we have the code for the process action submit. And in this case, we are going to get from the action request the file name, and we create an object that is input that is a list of input file object that is the input files needed by the application. And in this list, we set the name of the input file and the actual file using these two methods. Then we create an input sandbox object that is just an array of string, and we get the filter used selected by the user through the user interface. And if the user has selected any filter, we get we set the arguments using the minus f option. And then another option that can be specified is the number of faults, that means the number of execution of Weka on the same dataset. Finally, we get the classifier from the action request. And this is the code required to create a new task for the future gateway. In Weka, we create a package that create an object task, and we invoke the create task on the client object, and pass it the input and the app input object and the username of the user. The create task method implement all the code required to invoke the create task API of Future Gateway. Then we check that the status of the task is waiting, because when the task creation returns, it fill some attribute of the task object, for example, the status. And in this case, we are going to check that the status is waiting. Otherwise, some error could happen, and you should manage them there. At this point, as you saw yesterday, the second step is to actually upload the file to the remote site, to the Future Gateway. And in this case, it is done by this code. By this code, and that, as you can see here, it creates a list of link object that is also an object implemented in to wrap the link object inside the JSON. And from links we set the input. We get the input field, and using the client upload file, we actually upload the file inside the URL provided by the Future Gateway when you create the task. The last step, if everything goes well, it's to set the new page that should be shown to the user when it completes. And it is the submit JSP that just informed the user about his submission, and it just informed the user that his submission goes well. To get the output, you can refer to the My Jobs that you saw before in the last presentation. Here we have some reference about the Java implementation, the Java specification, and the Liferay documentation. And I forgot to put a link to the GitHub repository where the code of this application is used, because you can actually clone this code and reuse this application as starting point to develop, if you would like to develop application with these technologies. Thank you very much for your attention.